Pretty sure that's the first verse to Cthulhu Fathagen, but
it's got the word Wanko in it, so I'm endeared to it. And welcome back to another Linux Gamecast Weekly, the show that covers the latest Linux gaming news, reviews, how-tos, and most importantly, whatever the hell else we come up with. Vince Stone here in a beautiful downtown Athens, Georgia, in a studio in front of a computer, clicking on bits. Live. And a man who's not a fly. He's not Brendel Jordan.
Yet.
Life goals, kids. That is one Jordan Sfong. And Pedro Mateus, or as he's known at the agency, the milkman.
Brendel Mateus.
Water milk?
Yep. Half skimmed.
Half skim. Yeah.
That's his nickname, Half Skim.
Half Skim. He's a new Bond villain. Half Skim.
Yeah, it's like Odd Job or Jaws or whatever, right? Yeah,
half skim. Don't ask how they work because like
milk. Yeah, he just like has a super soaker full of milk.
Yeah, sure. Together with you, Shadow Realm Dynamic helping us form Cocaine Voltron. What's up? What's new? Yeah, you were bringing that up. I talked about that in the pre super shows, and I can't make up my mind whether or not I want to play a Stellar Blade.
It's just too jiggly.
It might be just like too jiggly, but I think it's more to like the jiggly. I don't care. Yes, like one of seven people. I'm like, whatever. Like, is it a fun game, right? And Jordan and I were talking about like, yeah, I think we saw that trailer for it forever ago. And we're like, what is this? Like, we don't know what's going on. I wanted something like Bayonetta with some Nier thrown in, but I think it's more like Bloodborne, Souls like combat.
Very, very neary in just about everything except the healing items and the respawning enemies when you use one of the
and the infinite parrying, having to do that constantly.
Yeah, that's less Dark Souls and more Sekiro, if you want to go there.
Oh, this is all the same game in my head, Pedro. You guys realize anything with a bonfire is Dark Soul. I mean, this has got a bond chair.
Yes, yeah. It's just a little bench, not really at the...
it's a fucking fold-out chair.
Yeah, I mean, when you say bond chair...
It's a bond chair.
Given how, like, leather-clad everything is, that has a very different context for me.
Oh, is it PS5 only? All right, I guess that solves that then.
All right.
Put it on the wish list.
Yeah, all right. Listen, it's a fucking...
Click on the support button.
How many... Shit. Yes, it's PS5 only, much like Horizon and... That zombie game and Spider-Man.
God of War.
God of War.
Plants versus Spider-Man.
Yeah, I'd play that. It'd be a better love story than Spider-Man Remastered. Jordan Svang, what's up? What's new? I know over here, I did play around with NDI. NDI 6 is out. We are using NDI 5 right now. If you don't know about that, it's slinging video bits over the network instead of using a shitload of HDMI cables and splitters and all the other stuff. It's working pretty good, but I wanted to test out some things for a video I'm working on. A guide to getting the modern version set up. And they're like, hold the brakes. We're about to get this new version of NDI. And out of curiosity for like bandwidth constraints, because you know what? Most people, you're not going to go out and be like, hey, let's go buy a 10 gig fiber switch, right? And you're like, probably not. How does it work with 1 gig? It works. We'll say that.
Hello, swap partition. How do you do?
Yeah.
It works. You can send it over, but... I think one of the things is, here's what you want to test. NDI likes switches, not routers.
It's very, very, very layer 2 oriented protocol.
Yeah, no matter, and being able to test that with like, I threw a fucking router board 4011 at it, and it was like, uh-uh. Get that shit.
You don't want to route these packets. You want them to just get like, schlooped up.
You want it to be on just like, hardware accelerated. Like, that's what they want to fucking live on. That was my adventure this week. Jordan, you've been at home for 2 days. Like,
all by myself.
Do you have the volleyball?
No.
With
no.
A handprint on it.
See, I had that from the last time, so I didn't need to make a new one. No, it's just been very quiet. Yeah, that's like the weird thing is like, usually I can hear like, even if like Lonnie isn't talking or anything, I can still hear her like moving around the house and whatnot. So like all of the ambient noise is gone. And then when you hear it, when that breaks, it's like, who the fuck has broken into my house? Must kill.
We definitely talked about that.
You have a dog.
Pedro, do you have this thing? If I hear a strange sound, I have to get up, investigate, and more importantly, reproduce.
Yes. Like, yeah. Which is really annoying because you're sure that the noise came from that place, but you cannot reproduce it.
Dude, if it's a fucking broom sliding across a wall, hitting that and bouncing off the, I'm in there actively moving shit around. I'm like, how did this end up like that? Okay, there's the fucking sound. All right.
You gotta break it down and come up with the individual composite sounds and be like, okay, so it made that noise when it hit this thing. It made that noise when it hit that thing. Mm-hmm. So now I can reverse engineer the path.
I need that confirmation or like my brain is not going to shut up.
It's fucking ghosts, man.
Yeah, it's especially bad when you're already, you know, under the covers and almost falling asleep and you hear the...
Yeah, that's just the immediate, like, God damn it.
Especially living in a house. you get like the random house noises and you're like, what the fuck is that?
And then you stand in the living room in the dark for like 2 minutes and you hear it again and you realize, oh, that was the dehumidifier plastic cooling down and snapping back into place.
Oh, I just stand in the dark living room by myself for extended periods of time. That's my default state.
Get up. Somebody walks by, give him a hug.
Sometimes I'm in the mood to be like that dude from The Blair Witch. I just want to stand in the corner and look creepy. I was about to say,
get blown off by the fucking studio. And But seriously, Pedro, when you're not on our new show, which is like Ghost Hunters, but it's like Noise Hunters. It's really boring. There's no
milk, milk Hunters.
Milk Hunters.
No. The milk story, you can listen to the pre super shows story, if you're that curious.
The milk epic, Pedro. It is a saga.
The epic,
actually,
epic of
I'll give you a new bit of milk trivia about me. Oat milk. I've been into the barista oat milk.
I'm gonna edit that where he just says oat milk and we're gonna immediately cut to the next segment.
Oat milk. It's the steam.
Oat milk.
I mean, yeah, that's
a little bit of trivia for you.
Yeah, just go watch the live and uncut version because the rest of you in the audience been around is like, yeah, I'm not above doing that.
No.
What about oat milk?
What about it?
It tastes nice.
That's what I hear of all like the various grain milks. Oat milk is like closest to milk in terms of
I don't
of
think
taste.
I've messed with oat milk. I've had like almond milk and I'm like,
yep. It's expensive. It's really expensive.
I sipped on it. Like, I have no desire to fuck with milk in the first place. I was like, all right. It kind of tasted like water.
It's very watery.
Mm.
Just like
the horse. They tend to be.
Yeah, all right. Fuck you. Roll with that. Go for it.
Yeah, I mean that's, watery I mean, like that's what horse. Happens when you marinate
is it like
a horse
hungry
in
like
almond
the wolf,
milk,
but
for,
milk
for like a month. It's the
Water like the horse, man.
It's the water of life. It's like Shai Halud
of our first album.
You drink the horse.
Water.
You can lead the water to the horse, but you can't make it.
Linux Gamecast. Water like the horse, Volume 1.
It's like hungry like the wolf, but it's water like the horse.
Water like the horse. Let's talk about watery refunds because here's the thing that I really didn't even know about. I never thought about it, but once I read about it, I'm like, why? You know, it makes. You know, a little bit of sense, right? Just a little bit of sense. What are we talking about? Prefunds. I'm talking about early access. Oh, no. When you get over here, like refund policy. Ooh, we got that update. What's going on? Well, they've updated a portion of the refund policy regarding pre-purchase titles, which are not. What are you thinking? Like early access, right? And I'm like, oh, shit. Why is that?
Advanced access was the thing that really threw me off.
These are different. This is the playtime that you get, man, when you drop that extra cash to get like that extra day, 2 days, 3 days, maybe a week before all the peasants, you know, sully the game. Well, it turns out, I was like, wait, what? Turns out, like however long that window was, if you bought it and you could speedrun that shit or just have some fun with it and get done, you could do a full refund as long as you did it before the game officially launched. And Valve's like, sure.
It seems like an odd loophole to keep in place, but not anymore.
No, they're closing that out, and it's only going to affect the assets that were abusing it.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Can you imagine?
I don't think anyone else cares.
No, dude, it's one of those situations where those people are mad, but they know they can't say anything about it.
Right. Yeah. Because they're like, we're clearly taking advantage of the broken system. How dare you fix it and allow the developers to keep their money?
Oh, can you imagine this, though? You know, the self-aware wolf motherfucker. You know, Valve has received fucking email from these people going, what the hell, man?
Why can't I refund my game? Yeah.
Right. And oh, no, saying you need to roll this change back, man. Like,
yeah, no, I think it's 2024. If you're pre-ordering a video game, you're the problem. You are why we can't have nice things. But yeah, no, it sucks. You don't get special treatment no more. But given the state of the games industry
now. What if my pre-order comes with a little figurine?
And it's exclusive. Then you just buy that shit on eBay like 5 years later for £20. But yeah, no, it's if you pre-order games at this point, given the state that the industry is in and given the state that video games come out in these days, just don't fucking do it. Just don't.
But what if I want to save the time?
Full game for free. Otherwise, right?
Like, yeah, right. I mean,
you pirate it like everyone else.
Pedro, I don't want to wait the 15 to 23 minutes it's going to take to download it. I want to have it pre-downloaded when it launches because reasons.
It's FOMO. That's,
yes, FOMO.
I want to be the first person in our Discord to post a screenshot of it and say I don't like it.
Yes, they have to swing the E-peen on their favorite Discord server to say, I totally have this game that you don't have. Yes.
Have you ever pre-ordered anything?
I have, but was like at a store where you had to like still like go buy like a physical thing.
Okay. What was it?
It was a Pokemon game.
Okay.
I bought Skyrim 5 hours before it came out. Because I basically set up everything and I wanted to be ready when it came out to just do the unlock of the file decryption and start playing. So I bought it early for that reason.
Man, if I'd done that, Valve would have been like, this is not verified, re-downloading. I'm like,
yeah, like, again, pre-orders made sense in an era when, like, there was a physical object that
scarcity
you needed to
existed.
Go get.
Yeah, it wasn't digital. Oh, yeah. Oh,
unless
marketers.
Your name is Nintendo and your manufacturing said scarcity. Yes.
Marketers, here's what you do. You put a number on the Steam store page of like,
your purchaser
NFTs
number X.
NFGs, baby. NFGs, non-fungible games.
Non-fungible Gokus.
Kakarots, what are you talking about, son? Yeah, I mean, again, this only affects people who are doing that. And you know what? I'm not even going to fault somebody who was doing that because I'm like, you're only hurting the people that were selling early access to a game in the first place. So, like, whatever. Yep. Victimless crime, way I'm looking at it.
Yeah.
Moving on to, they're Proton getting so much better with these. We don't have to do diffs on GitHub.
You still need to learn a little bit of Git command line because sometimes they do sometimes highlight the changes, but sometimes they don't, and it's always good to check. The changes at the top are emboldened. We're talking about the change log for Proton Experimental as of April 22nd. And they added some D3D12 support for OpenVR, Horizon Forbidden West gets fixes, there's some Proton 9 regressions for Overwatch 2, and there are a few games as well that were modified to accommodate for high core count CPUs.
Doesn't this activate the Winter Soldier?
Yeah.
Pretty sure that's the first verse to Cthulhu Fathagen, but
it's got the word Wanko in it, so I'm endeared to it.
So Strider was talking about that game. You play as a dog, and the goal is to like destroy a house while you're a dog.
That sounds like what a Wanko would do.
Listen, I get that in real life. I don't need to play a video game to experience that.
All right, with your bounty of Wankos,
I'm a major Wanko, don't you know?
All right, sure.
I mean, he is alone at home for several days, so there's probably been a lot of
playable 10 of the games, which are, I ran into this for the longest time. I bought the game, the modern incarnation of Strider, right?
Yes.
I wanted Strider because we were too poor to for me to get that as a kid on the Mega Drive, because it was like a bazillion extra dollars more than a regular Mega Drive game. And I'm like, eh, I want to try the remake. It's been forever. So it wouldn't run on my Threadripper. Get the fuck out of here with my first world problems. I know. Why didn't it run? Too many cores.
Mm-hmm. Gotta split the Numa nodes.
Many cores. And I'm
Numa,
like,
Numa, Numa.
Well, my brain went, don't care enough to go into the I didn't ever bother with it. And there's a Mooncliffe command to nerf cores anyway. But that's what they did for 10 other games that had the same problem, because this was a real issue back in the day. Like when you're making a game in like the hot new CPU, Intel had four cores. Intel, that was like 1,000 dot Intel. Yeah, you might have only did like one core or two cores, or then it just, I wonder how that works. I'm sure Scott will explain. Is like, if you see more than four, if error, because like, yeah, you're just reading something wrong. Nobody's going to make a six core CPU.
No one's gonna make a three core CPU.
$1,000 Intel
fucking CPUs. AMD,
yeah, yeah.
Those were the six core ones.
Yeah. you get like AMD. AMD's like, well, that one's a knackered. What do you do? I'm like, ship it.
Well, I mean, that was like the Athlon era, right? Like that was back when, like, yeah, AMD was still like a very huge second fiddle to second banana to Intel.
Yeah, I mean, yeah, they couldn't afford to throw out anything, dude. So yeah, when you hear like three core, five core, I'm like, yeah, AMD, probably.
Yeah.
Yeah. They're like, does it work a little bit? All right, ship it. Let's go.
Can we bin it to win it? Oh yeah. $50.
Now, both of you love playing strip roguelikes, right?
I just enjoy stripping in general.
Oh, that's a dangerous combination. But I know I like my roguelike deck builders. Deck builders.
Only hear what you want.
Seriously, if you're walking down the street and the builders start heckling you, dick them. Dick them hard.
just pull your penis out. LGC cares.
But yeah, no. Ars Technica is actually asking, why are there 861 roguelike deck builders on Steam all of a sudden? And the article breaks down. It's like, okay, the example they use is Slay the Spire, which I've played a lot of. Jordan's played a lot of. It's a genuinely good game. And they speak on why the developers chose to build the game like that. And then they start going into the finer points. It's like, lower overhead, efficient assets. Yeah, you draw the cards and that's it. That's the mechanics, that's the character, that's everything. And it's easy to do. It's the cost is also one of the points that they bring up. It's very easy to do. You can do it with very few people. And you have a visual representation of the mechanics directly without having to spend a lot of time on graphics, without having to spend a lot of time on
lads, we're in the wrong the business
presentation.
I was streaming some deck builders for a while. I was doing
the social aspect also works, because that kind of game lends itself very well to the backseat gaming. So if you're a streamer,
to that point as well, I think one thing that they kind of missed out on is with deck building in general, there's like quite a large degree of personal expression, because the cards that you pick and prune from your deck very much are informed by your playstyle and your priorities. So like Magic the Gathering runs into this a lot with like people identify with like pieces of the color pie, because because it allows them to express themselves in a specific way within the game. And I think that is the ability to do that is a very powerful thing that is underexplored in some games.
I think Pedro is really tapping into one of the things with for like the social interaction on like Twitch.
Yes.
100%, because if you can do the deadly double where you can feign being a little dumb and get that market, and also feign the, well, actually, by intentionally being just a little wrong, where you get that double dip in the chat.
And you have people actively interacting with you and talking about the game, which also reflects well on the game, and the developers kind of like that because that's more sales.
The article brings up as well, and this was the big reason for me, is I really, really like like Magic the Gathering and trading card games, I cannot afford to play these motherfuckers. So this is really the only way I can scratch that itch. And a lot of people have been priced out of their CCG of choice as well. So these are a perfect little
opportunity. Yeah, I mean, you get to buy the cards and take them home and you got to paint them and like put them on the little table.
Yeah. It's a lot of money.
Yeah, no, my question's not about the roguelike deck builders. I absolutely understand that. They're also infinitely replayable because everyone's going to be a little bit different. So yeah, it is. I get those.
Also, as a marketing thing, that's also really good because I can watch you play the game and I'm not going to have the same experience. So. Mm-hmm.
All right, ladies and gentlemen, tune in next week when this Linux Gamecast will be replaced by Magic the Solitaire.
The Legend of Soltar. Thank you very much.
The big question in my mind is, what's with all the extraction shooters and survival games? That's what I'm worried about. I get the survival elements can make a game fun. Fallout New Vegas doesn't really exist without hardcore mode for me. But the fucking netty bars. What's the appeal? I don't get it.
Stress.
How's that appealing? I get plenty of that shit at work.
People like Dark Souls because it stresses them out. I don't know. You tell me.
I like Dark Souls because it makes me feel like a badass.
And there's stress up until that point, so I don't know.
I just like Dark Souls like lets people with bad reflexes feel good about playing video games. If you disagree with me, leave a comment on the video. All right. Now we're gonna do another segue since Pedro took a howitzer that first one. Something not controversial at all.
Yes, let's not say that one of the most beloved tools ever since Proton was introduced and the community got together and created ProtonDB. Let's say that sucks. Yeah. No. Okay. They do put a let me explain at the end of the
Wait. No taxi backs. He's already got the article here that says it sucks.
Yeah, no, you don't take it back. You just add a let me explain at the end. But this comes from Notebook Check, which is a website that I do actually read because I like laptops and that's like their bread and butter. Julian van de Merve, yes, has opinions about ProtonDB. Specifically, he brings up, there's the screenshot right there, that Paladins, for example, it's been broken forever. Because the developer choked on the glue stick that they were munching in their favorite anti-cheat flavor. And the game sometimes works, sometimes it doesn't. It depends on how they implement the anti-cheat. And it is still showing a bronze rating on ProtonDB, which is wrong because the game doesn't work. So... yes, I absolutely agree that if a developer does do something that stupid, there should be some manual intervention. There should be someone says, nah,
I think, game is broken. I think the solution is we have like a ruined by anti-cheat label on ProtonDB so that, it's got the platinum ranking and whatnot. But like, yeah, you can't play with other people or whatever. Just like name and shame it and just make a secondary category for just like, well, is there anti-cheat, yes or no, and does it actually work?
Mm-hmm. I'm just more impressed that there's a hyperlink, you know, at the end that to sum up there, you know, if you're looking to game on Linux but want something more powerful than a Steam Deck, the Lenovo Legion Go.
Ah, with this affiliate link.
Dude, this thing is so weaponized.
Oh man. Yes. By the way, if you head on over to linuxgamecast.com and mouse over the support button, we have affiliate links as well that you can click on to help us out.
And they don't fucking trigger Ublock.
They don't go through the tracking bullshit that Ublock Origin just goes, nope, not touching it.
Yeah. Pedro, like you would do this though, wouldn't you?
Here's the thing. I like video games. I do. Like video games a lot. And the whole concept behind preservation.
You may be able
and
to produce some supporting evidence to that. I'll believe you for now, though.
I think he just says that he likes video games.
I don't know. Man.
Almost 11 years that we've been doing this. I've hated video games.
I mean, I could make some arguments, man.
Yeah, you're just doing it for the clout.
But yeah, it is. I don't envy the kind of position that would require someone to maintain that and actively validate all of the not all of the results, but all of the like the ratings. Yeah. Well, basically it, like, just have, okay, this game is platinum. Let's check if you just install it and run it and play it, if it is in fact out of the box experience. And doing that for every single game listed on ProtonDB, I would need about £50,000 after tax, and I would do that. I would go through each individual game. I would test it. Hey?
I muted him. Finish.
I would go through each individual one. I would start with the games that I already own, obviously, but I would eventually get through all the games on Steam, because for that amount of money I would just buy the games. That's fine.
Jordan, you're not really muted. I just have that.
All right. Fair enough. I don't know. Like you said before, you pull this shit, so I don't fucking know. I was just gonna say, like, part of this though is like I don't think you could have like the one man in the chair doing all of this, because ProtonDB, this issue is like, it's not necessarily a problem, but it is a symptom of the fact that there is a lot of fragmentation just in the PC space in general. Because it's not just, is this game platinum? Is it platinum on your video card, on the specific driver that you're running, on the specific version of the distribution that you're running? And so at a certain point, you're going to need a community source database in order to maintain all the various permutations of all the various, the combinations. And I'm sure there's a way to do it. I'm not smart enough to figure it out, but like, figuring out a way to distill this, like maybe ProtonDB like has a thing where you press a button and it checks your hardware and it says like, here are the games that we know work for this particular hardware, ranked by like some heuristic based on like recency of operating system or something, right? But that would require a lot of work. That would require a lot of number crunching. Yeah. I just don't know like how, but like I don't really see any other sort of solution. Valve, for their part, they're just like saying target the Steam Deck on the Steam Store. It will tell you if it runs on the Steam Deck or if it doesn't run on the Steam Deck, or if your mileage may vary. But even
Valve's own system, as we've discussed on a number of occasions, is not entirely perfect. And
it's not, but like,
there's a couple of different ways like looking at this, man. Like, there's an opportunity here. I was thinking about this because Pedro brought up like, you know, 50,000 quid a year, right? Now, to do this, what do we realistically need? You're going to need a Steam Deck, an NVIDIA card, an AMD card. And to what Jordan's saying, there's so many games. Yeah, let's stick with the top 100. Like the games that are the popular ones right now. Let's say you like really wanted to do this and you wanted to start testing them. Problem is, like, that's not a $50,000 a year job. That's a low-skilled job. I could take somebody off the street and have them being proficient in testing these games in, you know, a structured environment by the end of the week. And I know anybody who's been in, like, management or hiring is like, yeah, I've trained dumber people to do more complex things. It wouldn't be that big a deal. However, I said there's an opportunity to this, and there is. If you're sitting around, like, there is a value to actual testing a data point. Even if it's just the games you get, you've been looking like, hey, I want to start a YouTube channel. Here's your thing. It's going to require all the perspiration, though. You're going to need that NVIDIA card. Maybe just get a Steam Deck. Actually playing this, getting video evidence of it, something that is searchable where I can see. Not, oh, it runs fine on my system. Nah, let me see it running fine. Yeah, give me a 1080p.
I was thinking, like, because there was that the cheater website, right, where you have to like show evidence. Would we need like show me a screen like a video of your system that has like the Neo Fetch or whatever, and the game starting up and getting into the tutorial or whatever?
Well, do we need basics. That level of evidencing? I mean, we're not looking for like hyper broke down like all the fucking resolutions. I was like, can it run? Does it, you know, that thing? Because eventually, you know, that's going to be a bunch of fucking extra work. You probably already got a full-time job, but you know, you look at the origin story of any successful fucking YouTuber, Twitch streamer, they started with a full-time job and that's the shit they did. Look at the long-term. Even if it doesn't take off, you're doing a good, you got to come up with like how you want to test it and how you want to sell it. Then you look at the future of where, hey, you might be able to get these in videos of actual human testing embedded in the damn ProtonDB thing. If you come up like straight enough.
speaking of the future, I think it's going to get, I think it may get worse before it gets better, because with the prevalence of ARM computers and throwing like Box 86 into the mix, mm-hmm. now this becomes like, will this run? Well, I don't know.
That should be its own category, because you have in ProtonDB, you have the desktop, you have the Steam Deck categories. You can have one for FEX, Box 64.
Sure, whatever. Sure. I'm just saying, like, we're going to have to start accounting for that as well. So it's not just like how well does it run natively versus Wine. It's like how well does it run natively ARM versus Wine ARM versus Box 86 ARM.
I don't think that's even like, because that was not what ProtonDB was about. It's about whether or not the game runs at all.
Right.
Like you always expected the performance delta between native Windows and Linux.
but that's the point. Like there seems to, at least currently, or at least based on what the article is saying, there seems to be like a lack of this resolution of information. So eventually it will have to expand to cover that.
Like, somebody's going to take suggestion earlier
wasn't
is,
even to take away the community aspect of it. It's to maintain the community aspect of it, but have someone actively checking and whose job it is to actively reinforce those ratings.
And there's your opportunity.
Sure, they're accurate.
Somebody needs to execute on it. Like if that's your thing, you're looking to get a start doing it. Nobody's going to fucking pay you to do it. That ain't happening. However, you take it on yourself, there's a chance there to build something. Think about it. Plus, like I said, if it doesn't take off, you're
apply
helping
to
people
co-leavers.
Out.
You have a bunch of experience on that resume now.
All right. But yeah, if you're sitting around waiting for somebody to hire you to do that, that ain't never gonna happen. What do we got up next? Oh man.
Garry's mod.
Speaking of SteamDB, man, which we were, but let's pretend we were. Nintendo has come a knocking. I played Garry mod. I think I looked at it. I got like 10 minutes in Garry's mod. Long enough to open it up and like, I'm the fuck with whatever. Close.
My experience with Garry's mod is a Gmod idiot box on YouTube.
All right. Fair enough. Nintendo has sent a takedown request to any related content on Garry's mod that rhymes with Mario, Wario,
Ario.
Yellow Rats.
Xario.
We're working on removing all Nintendo related stuff from the Steam Workshop. Like, oh, that's not a problem. You know, just go in there, click on a few things, get rid of it. It's, pretty straightforward until start thinking about how long has Garry mod been now? 20 years of shit they're gonna have to sort through. On top of that, you know, this went down a while ago. The DMCA, they didn't even know if it was real at first. They had to investigate that because apparently somebody's like hobby. Like they've achieved a new level of just like, wow, it's just spamming false DMCAs for like Garry's, but just trying to get stuff pulled down, like community made models and stuff that people have made over the years. Why? Because I can't
gotta
even
lick
imagine
that boot.
What?
gotta lick that corporate boot, I guess. Nintendo will give you a job for sure.
There was the story of that guy that got Yuzu looked at basically because they wouldn't introduce the changes that he wanted. Do you think this is a similar situation that Garry's mod pissed off someone at that level that now they've Uncle Nintendo?
The sentence Garry's mod pissed off someone is just generally true. So.
And you know, yes. Garry, the caring, loving foster of a community and responsibility with everyone, has politely asked, hey, if you want to help us out, just go ahead and delete that Nintendo related content that you uploaded 16 years ago.
And never you still have the login for that?
Right. On that Steam account that you got banned.
Right, yeah.
But no, apparently this is legit. Garry himself, you can see the tweet under the quote tweet under the SteamDB post, which is, we've been assured that the takedowns have been verified by Nintendo as legit. So, oh shit. So if that's the case, I say we give Nintendo exactly what they seem to want. Let's just cut them out. Just not mention Nintendo. Just not talk about Nintendo. Just
we need publicly domain, like legally distinct Mario characters.
They like tried Mario
and Louis.
Remember Super Mario World, which Empress used to be Super Mario World until Nintendo came in knocking 20 years ago to the open source project, and they're like, Then we got Mario.
Yes, Mario.
Giana Sisters.
That was just a dumb game anyway. That's not our only update this week. Up next, we have 12 years of Closure. Who remembers Closure? Because I didn't. I knew I had it. I knew it's a game. It exists.
It was in a Humble Bundle, yes.
It's like, actually. Yeah, a little black and white run around. You know, it was a thing of its time. We had a bunch of games like this, like Braid and
Limbo.
Yeah, that comes to mind. Reason we want to give this a mention is this is an update in 2024 for a game that came out 12 years ago. And holy hell, did Mac users get like a big chubby for a second. They're like, we've updated the Mac, dot, dot, dot. For Intel Mac users, like, mother, I know somebody's mad. Why are we updating this? Well, there's a, this was kind of wild. People were playing this. The best experience to play this game on a modern PC was through a PS3 emulator.
Our PS3, baby.
That's a bit fucked. So dude was like, we probably need to just kind of update this a little bit. And it's got SDL2 now under the hood. The shaders have been ported from NVIDIA CG to good old fashioned, I guess it's now, well, new to them, GLSL. And yeah, it's pretty cool. It does the cloud save with the cross platform now, which is also cool.
We gotta give a big old shout out to Flippidgy Bibba Bo Ethan Lee for helping out with this. He's taken that on. He's if you have a game that is very, very old that you want it updated to run on modern systems, Ethan will do it for you, and he'll do it in a way that will just basically allow you to support this game indefinitely.
Yeah. Although I do like the, I appreciate the dev's admission of, like, it was referencing a lot of files on the desktop or the C drive of the PC I made the game on, and as such, it would not build on any newer PCs without recreating the environment exactly.
Ah,
yeah, that's the game preservation right there.
So we will ship your machine, run it in a Docker container.
Yeah, here's the fucking image. Have fun.
Yeah.
That's always good when you see this. Like, somebody thought about it. You know, I'm sure this was more of a situation of like, I still like money. Let's make sure this is running on the Steam Deck, right? I mean, out of the goodness of his heart. And game preservation. Whatever you need to tell yourself.
Game preservation. Maybe he cares about the thing that he made, and he's like, "All right, I'll finally get around to doing fixing it."
Or the conscience guilt was finally like, "Okay, I got to do something about it."
Yeah, dude, I am the ghost of Intel Mac's past. You need to update your game. Woo!
But I, you know what? It probably was like the fucking PS3 because I know if I was like, "Oh goddamn."
Oh yeah, yeah. They saw the PS3 thing and they're like, yeah. Let's
That's not a good look.
It's like, okay, no, that's an itch I just can't scratch. Let's just fix that.
Jordan, have you ever received a package?
I mean, yes.
Not from Amazon.
Amazon? Yeah, I've received non-Amazon packages.
I mean, you might have like, I don't know, sexy Amazon delivery.
No, that guy stopped showing up, but that's because I kept answering the door naked, and I'm a little sad. Maybe I burned that bridge, but maybe I can get some cool toys in a box, some small soldiers. There's an update to Hypercharged Unboxed. We attempted to play this several times in the after show to mixed results, but they have a new update coming with some bug fixes and Xbox crossplay. So that's neat. I do wonder if that means that this is coming to Game Pass in the near future, because they're like, hey, we want people to play this game, and we want people who already bought it to be able to play it with the friends on the Game Pass. So
that would actually help with the numbers. Yes.
Yeah.
What do you mean? You get a hate on them, man. They got a healthy core player base.
Yeah.
how many the people who just played that game and that game alone?
Yeah. I mean, it's pretty... It's stable. It's a stable number.
two columns. There's a stable base.
All 11 of you. You even got one to spare for team on team.
No, you get a spectator, so you can broadcast, right? Right. Like,
yeah, somebody's got
it's
the camera.
It's the TV channel. Yeah.
Oh man. You know, for a game that average, like, again. If it's a multiplayer on the, that's a very important metric to bring up, especially if you're thinking about playing a game, because if you run into a game, 11 is, it's kind of rough, but even if it was like 100, I'd go, ooh, and I'm talking about me wanting to get into a game and playing, because if there's 100 people playing a game regularly, you're going to get wrecked.
Yeah.
they're gonna fuck you up.
Number 99 was the worst person on that yes. server, but he is still leaps and bounds above you.
Like,
so
I could just imagine, like, we're not gonna do it tonight, we would probably like get insta killed the second you spawn if we jumped into just, this like, with a 10. Sniped.
Yeah,
it's like,
what was that? What was that one MOBA we were playing where we all got in the car and then like that one sniper just shot all of us?
Oh right, Fode.
Yeah.
Fuck off and die. Yeah.
Yeah. We were having a good time, minding our own business and driving around in our Jeep. Then then
it was like I died, and then I'm like, what happened? And then you died.
Yeah.
They're up on the rock, and we died.
So, as Jordan hinted at, man, like the last time this game got a big update, it was last year, which we collectively would, because the original demo, like they sent us keys for this, like he tried to like give me bonus keys and do it. And I'm like, we played it, and after it was all right. Then after that update, we tried to play it on Linux again, and it was a shit fest. Like it was bad. I couldn't get it to capture my damn cursor and like a bunch of stuff. Then we tried to run Proton. We just gave up after like 2 maps.
Yeah, like the multiplayer was like super laggy and shit. Yeah. Like it was not.
I'm glad this is a passion project. So keep it up. Maybe it'll get some traction. Maybe go check. How much does this thing cost? $24.99.
That's a little spicy. Hopefully it is actually coming to Game Pass, and I just make that up.
Yeah, that would be dope. I mean, that's again. Oh, there's a free demo now though.
Oh, hey,
look at that! Like go try it out. Yeah, try it. Online PvP. It's got co-op apparently. So yeah, there you go. And they did
Green Army Men.
Way back when the Steam Deck came out. Remember that? They went back and made sure it was working on deck. Good. So yeah, good on that. Let's get into the news. This is a Pedro story. If a Pedro story ever in a field of Pedro stories. Was walking.
I don't
by.
Know if it's ever been on the show before, but the Fallout.
But there's a new version, so.
Yeah, the Fallout Community Edition versions are a thing, especially for Fallout 1 and Fallout 2. If you like the original games, and now that the show is popular, you know, might want to give it another look. There's new versions out.
Let me tell you about Pedro. I always love Fallout now that the show is popular.
Yeah, there's a lot of people playing, and you've probably seen the news of every single Fallout game basically doubled their amount of concurrent players on Steam ever since the show went live. So there's that. But Fallout 1 Community Edition, they released the new master build.
They do like a yearly update on both of these projects.
In March, Fallout 2 Community Edition, the big roundup also came out in April. So yeah, you have new stuff to go play around with. I very much into the Fallout 2 one because I'm just waiting for them to introduce S-Fall compatibility. Because it's sort of kind of there now. They have Olympus.
What is S-Fall, Pedro?
S-Fall is the mod injection thing for the original Fallouts. It also allows like higher resolutions and DirectX 9 rendering. And it was basically the mod that enabled the games to run as well as they do currently on modern systems and other mods to run on top of them, like the Fallout 2 Restoration Project, which honestly, ever since I tried that mod, it doesn't change much in the original Fallout 2. It just fixes a bunch of bugs and introduces some of the stuff that was originally meant to be in the game but was cut. They actually went into the game files and reused as much as they could.
It's like that KOTOR thing that Aspyr keeps selling as their own product that the community developed. So speaking of bug fixes, there are a couple ones in this release. A lot of damage recalculation and perk stuff. But elevators work now, which is crazy because in the distant future, in the post-apocalypse, the elevators do work, but in my old building, they do not.
Also, it works on Android. So, yep. Pretty dope.
And Haiku. Ask me how I know.
Is there some screenshots hiding in here somewhere that are not on the page?
It's Fallout 2. It's Fallout 1.
As somebody who's never seen either.
The original game.
Okay. So that's a no?
All right. No.
Okay. Do kids know what to do with configuration files? Like, everybody in our age. So I'm going to use Jordan as the youngest. So what? What are you, 30?
I'm 34.
34 is the, I'm going to say, my cutoff. You just know, right? You just go digging around. You're looking for an INI file. You don't even think twice about it. You don't go check the internet. You're like, all right, where's the fucking INI file?
Yeah, you do find for star INI. Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
And you get in there. And like, that's not even moon glyphs. That's like perfectly like control F, right? You're looking for like windowed or resolution. Is that just going to be like lost?
Like, oh, yeah, probably.
It's not going to be any more lost than it currently is, because yes, well, we know about it, but the bulk of the rest of the gaming population probably doesn't.
Just the general computing population, I think, right? Like, you tell people to go edit an INI file, they're going to look at you like you just asked
literally
them to sacrifice
your any
firstborn.
Console gamer, you tell them to edit the config file and they go,
they probably just laugh at you. I'm like, I can't do that. I'm on a console, dumbass.
So I think there will always be like the nerds and the geeks that will have their dot files and their config files and their INI files and whatever else.
I mean, this is what I'm curious. Let me know, like, if you're 35 or under, both of you might be watching the show. I know, like, okay, I need to get this into a windowed mode because, hey, I want to stream it, but I'm looking in the options. There's not a option for windowed mode. Immediately, I think, all right, let's close the game, go into Steam apps or wherever the game's located and start digging around. Like, hey, can I just find that? Like, I don't Google or anything. Is that your natural reaction? Or you just go, get fucked and return the game?
I've gotten into the habit of clicking F12 or Alt-Enter to see if it toggles windowed mode.
And like, GameScope. Solve problem.
And it might be like a resolution, or it might be something else you want to add. Like, resolution's taken care of with GameScope. Yeah, like, that's just straight up baby mode, man.
I mean, we live in a great little world now where it could just be like, oh, you think you can, this is your display.
I wasn't asking.
This is your display, trust me. Just there.
Yeah.
Yeah, full screen. Do whatever you want, man. It's yours. Go nuts.
Full screen, window, don't matter. That's your display.
So it's time for me to put on my scarf and sit on top of my doghouse and fly my plane around. Yeah. So Sopwith. I did not know what this was until recently. The Sopwith itself is apparently a British aviation company, and this is STL Sopwith, which is a STL game of the STL port of the old PC game. It was a biplane shoot 'em up. You can run it in a browser. I think that's like, honestly, I think that is the biggest boon to like game preservation these
days. Look at the system requirements, like, baby.
Yeah. Like ASM.js, where you can just like fucking run full ass apps in the browser. And now you can just like run Sopwith. I tried it out. I crashed my plane a bunch. I realized that I'm terrible at dropping bombs from old biplanes. And you can too if you follow the link in our show notes. And give it a shot.
I'm down with it, man. A couple of interesting things about this. You know, I never played it myself. Like, I knew it existed. I think Empty, like, is like, I remember playing it. I'm like, I remember seeing this. Or I saw something that was a clone of it at the time. Originally released, how long was 1981 ago? A couple of years ago. Like, you know, a decade.
20 minutes?
Yeah. August 1981.
43 years, but yes.
Yeah. Last week.
20 minutes. Yeah.
Got an early access on Steam. So that's like OG PC. Like, which one? The first x86. You know, what you'd really consider like a real PC.
IBM.
Right.
Ibrahim. Yeah.
Also one of the earliest. They didn't say the, but I think they were kind of like flexing on this. They're like, probably though, if you do the right optics, network games. You should have multiplayer, dude. Like, fuck yes. And it is definitely one of the oldest games still in active development compared to like what's another, like NetHack? That's kind of
NetHack or like Pong or stuff like that. It's of that vintage.
That's
pretty
dope.
Pong is, I guess, a little older, but like I was listening to a podcast. Apparently, someone played when he was a kid. He got to actually play Space War, that multiplayer shooter. Like that was on an oscilloscope where it was like fucking asteroids versus the Enterprise.
But yeah, I'm an expert player. How do I?
All right, let's see you speed run this.
I don't know. All how right. do I move?
Well, welcome back to Linux Games Done Quick. It is ZX and
fuck
yeah. It tells you that the controls. Cow's dead.
Right over the cow.
How do I go up? How do I put these flops down?
I think it's like question mark or one of the brackets.
I don't know. Yeah. We did.
We did. X, Z, and comma and period.
All right. Oh, man. Slash. This would be interesting. It's got shooting pupils. I didn't get a chance to play around. You know, it's very Atari 2600-esque, maybe like a high-end version of one. This would be great if it just had like online networking, right? Just get on and just get wrecked in pixel planes.
Well, but then you have like that fucking 13-year-old who has infinite time to spend on Sopwith calling you names because you're bad at flying a four-plane.
Have that 60-year-old whose only muscle memory is literally this game because that's all they've been playing since it came out.
We need that and controller support and
VR support, man. You gotta be first person in the pixel plane.
Dude, I want a full fucking flight yoke throttle.
Yeah, the HOTAS, yeah.
I think I remember seeing this game, but my like what I associate with it is the shrieky PC speaker noises that it was making while someone else was playing it. And even at the time I went, no, I don't want to play that.
Then your brain would sort out that garbled like.
Because I played a lot of Doom 2 with PC speaker noises. I did. We didn't have a sound card at
noises,
the time.
So music,
PC
though. Speaker it is. Noises.
I want to hear the quake through a PC speaker. I want to know what that sounds like.
You didn't, unfortunately. They were like, beep, 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 beep. Yeah, it was horrible. Horrible, Carl. But we could also play it on our HackMatrix, so.
I can't.
Pedro's got all of our VR equipment.
No.
No.
But I have no VR equipment.
I borrowed it from the office at
one point, and then I
returned it. Did they confiscate it?
You de-bezzled it. All right.
I've rebezzled it. This is the future eventually, hopefully. Like this is the only excuse that I can see for virtual reality ever existing after it's like super light glasses that you put over your eye holes and the battery lasts all fucking day. HackMatrix, a 3D Linux desktop environment, which can also be a game engine because why the hell not? And it's that, you know, it's what the Apple Vision YOLO does currently right now. It's like they can give you those virtual screens, not high resolution like the Apple one, but more AR than VR. But I mean, you can VR. What are we looking at? We got OBS open on the left. We got NeoFetch because hey, spot the new Linux user. I'm kidding.
Well, GitHub repo. They got Vim, so I don't know.
Yeah, but they've had that open for like four fucking weeks now.
They haven't been able to.
They
close
still
it.
Haven't figured it out.
And
how do I quit cigarettes? How do I quit Vim?
I mean, this makes sense, though. I mean, you pop, like, this is the use case I can see. Like, instead of having a bunch of damn monitors, just you put this on and you go for it. Like, you got the monitors there and move around. That's really all you can do right now, though, because this doesn't work with your VR headsets just yet, does it, Jordan?
No, it does not. It does not work with your Waylands either. It doesn't work with Fedora either, but I don't know whose fault that is because I tried compiling it and apparently SPD log is missing some header file, but I don't know if this is Fedora fucking up and not including that file or them not specifying what version of speed log they need. But I mean, it looks cool. I wanted to dick around with this and like, be the dean from community and be like, Alexander wept because there were no more worlds to conquer. I live in the future. But yeah, like once this becomes like, once this gets VR support and there is a closed issue that the guy says like, yeah, eventually not right now. I need to actually get this thing working normally before we look at converting it to Wayland and then to VR or VR and then to Wayland. Yep.
Yeah. Pedro, you looked at these dependencies and you're like, nah.
They have the DNF command to install most of the dependencies, as Jordan found out. but yeah, no, it is. What I want something like this, other than the Wayland and Gamescope support, obviously, is can I import, let's say I build Firelink Shrine from Dark Souls, can I import that to be my my like home area?
That's just like setting a wallpaper, right?
Yeah, but it's a 3D wallpaper.
Then you need to start learning Blender, my friend.
Nori's learning Blender. She'll do it.
It'd probably be easier to do it in like Unreal Engine 5 now. Did you see that latest update? Like, they're eating some motherfuckers' lunches. Well, that it got me interested. Cool project. Keep it up. And, you know, in the future, like every time we see something like this, we always like to bring it up because you got to start doing that foundation, right? You gotta have somebody working on it, so when it becomes a reality, it becomes a real boy. Like, hey, somebody's at least laid the groundwork down. You don't have to reinvent the damn wheel.
At the very least, figure out what doesn't work, right?
Like, yeah. And which that would be like Wayland right now. He's like, nah, I can make it work. I just don't want it right now. Which, fair. But when the VR support gets added, it's gonna come. So don't worry about it. Too much. Before we get out of here, we get a little bit of a hate mail. Maybe we said something during the show that you took offense to. You're like, I am offended. Or maybe you weren't offended. Even better yet, if you weren't offended, you can't help but be aroused. I mean, come on. I mean,
it's very, very titillating conversation about Linux games.
Aroused Pikachu behind you?
Yeah. that mouth is open for a reason. You gotta put a hot dog.
That's a Zoe face. Can't be seen. It's a tragic. You needed to move it over just a little bit. That way it would have Pikachu. Pikachu's denied. Aw. That's adorable. You can do that. Head over to linuxgamecast.com. We got a contact button. It's got an email address. If you need to send in a bunch of links and stuff like that, figure it out. Smash, hit send if you want. Leave a YouTube comment, as I brought up. Or you can drop us a note on the Patreon post. If you're one of the beautiful people supporting the show, making it possible, I'm like, goddamn, you're one of our bosses, so we're going to read it. Even if you're like, I know you guys are maybe not into a particular game.
Yeah, a turnover writes in, and they say, I know you guys don't have much interest in Factorio, but Factorio up their Linux and Wayland game. And they are referring to a blog post that they put out, where one of their folks was talking about what was involved in getting Linux support. And they mentioned a lot of Wayland support. Apparently there were some issues where they had some fallback code because they thought everything was on SDL, but then they had some legacy behavior that was also getting tripped, but they could remove it because SDL now runs everything. But they were talking about what was involved in getting Factorio ported over to Linux. There are people developing Factorio who use Linux, so primarily they do this to eat their own dog food, which is a great way to do it. They have people who want to develop on Linux, so you are responsible now.
That's fine.
For making it run
this
on
is fine.
Linux. Yeah,
it's working as intended. The game did not crash.
Indeed.
Watch it again.
No, but it's good to see because a lot of folks are like, oh, we'll just let Proton do it, or we'll just smash export on Unity or Unreal. And these guys are actually taking the time to properly make this work with Linux and ensure that like they're using a good framework like SDL and trying to be as platform agnostic as possible.
Yeah, so I mean, this is a good read. There'll be a link to this in the show notes. I mean, this is first contact with enemy, right? Like learning, going through the steps of like, okay, client side decorations. Maybe people want to close the window and you got some others. Oh, look, clipboard. That's going to be a fucking adventure. All right. But they're going through it, which is cool.
I did like their, I'm always looking for that confirmation bias.
Okay.
So, their,
that's why you switched to Sway, isn't it?
No. Still very much, well, I'm on Plasma 6 now because I'm running Fedora 40, but, the client side window decorations in GNOME have been a point of contention for a long time, ever since GNOME 3 was released and they made that a thing. And they just rip it. It's like GNOME in their infinite wisdom decided that all clients must provide their own decorations, instead of the desktop environment and the window manager doing what it's supposed to do and decorating the window. No, 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 no. It has to be the application that does it.
Well, I mean, every desktop manager can decide what they want or unwant to provide, right?
Oh, yes. It's just that for me, it's, oh, that's, yes, please. More evidence as to why GNOME made the worst desktop environment.
I don't know. You were railing pretty hard on Plasma earlier that week, Homer.
Yeah, and I will continue ripping into it.
How dare you?
Fucked it
up. Blindly defend KDE, goddammit.
That's the thing. I like KDE, but every single major release, they fuck it up. Every single time. God damn.
Just like Windows. Just like Windows. They look alike and they behave alike. It's great.
Yes. To a degree, yes.
Dude, has anybody played Factorio? I know it's methamphetamine for people who like these games.
So I have not personally, as I mentioned in the pre-segment.
It's also a benchmark.
My roommate was very big into Factorio, and he was into modding Factorio. Ooh. So he had like the recursive factories running within themselves.
That's making their own fucking meth lab right there.
Right, yeah. pretty much. So I know people go in deep. To the point where like he was just leaving his computer, his desktop running when he would go to work, because it's like, no, I don't want to lose Factorio progress. The thing's automated, so I need to get the number to go up.
Number gotta go per. I've never played it, and I want to say I've had my fill of those games, but that's not being completely honest, because that would mean that I had my fill of those games on like SimCity 2000. Like that was the last time I played anything like even remotely, because I know I was like, that's not the same. I'm like, it's probably not, but in my brain it is. This last time I played like a building simulator.
They do kind of look similar a little bit, yeah, with like making buildings on isometric perspective a little bit.
Send your hate mail to
Pedro at linuxgamecast.com.
Yeah, sure.
I don't know, Factorio in my head is like it's brown and it's got gears and shit in it.
Yeah, because the buildings,
yeah. I mentioned this in the pre-super shows, but I get why some people would genuinely like games like Factorio. I like Euro Truck Simulator 2. I like Mud Runner.
Because they're not colorblind.
But it's... no. If I wanted to do that level of automation, I'd be at work. No.
Some people like that shit, though, man.
Yeah, I guess it's like, it's the people who like go home and program for fun. It's like, no, it's what I do to get paid.
That was always like my joke. And it's like, I get done working security, bounce and come home, make dinner and watch Roadhouse.
Yeah. I got one thing on the brain.
This is what I do. This is my life, man.
Up next.
Good on them. So good on them for working on Wayland and keep on Linux support. Yeah, this one's directed at not Jordan and not Venn. Pedro has managed to acquire
a mustache.
A game stash. Yeah, he's like, he is the walrus.
Microsoft Game Stash coming soon. Right. All right, well, this is from Meow Meow 2646. And they ask Pedro, how did the gyro feel versus the DualShock? Sorry, how did the gyro feel versus the DualShock? I'm looking to buy a controller to use as a computer mouse on Windows.
Don't say that word around me. I'm watching the
I want the most accurate, precise gyro possible. I also love wireless. If the gyro is not much better than the DualShock, then I'll definitely get the DualShock for its wireless.
I can tell you, even with this being one of the earlier versions that they sent out for reviewers, thank you ever so much, Input Labs, it is by far a much more accurate, much more reliable gyro implementation than the DualShock 4.
It's got two, right? It's got two accelerometers.
Yeah, it has two gyros at the end of the PCBs, one on each side. And it basically just takes the value of the two and it does some math. They have the maths and everything else. It's the entire thing is open source, so you can see it for yourself.
The math is linked in our show notes.
Yes. And yeah, it is even like the litmus test for gyros is if you put the controller down on a table, you can see because the earth is spinning. And there's always allegedly vibrations and things. So you can see just how much the value wobbles just from having the controller set down on the table. And with the alpaca, the wobble is like 0.001 of a degree. You can use Steam, the Steam input calibration thing to check. It's like 0.001 of a degree. It's like up and down. It's like almost 1 degree for the DualShock 4. Like the wobble of it just being still on a desk.
What about the DualSense? Did you check that?
So I haven't tested the DualSense. but yeah, no, the legitimately, the alpaca, if you can get one built and you really like the gyro. Yeah, absolutely. The Steam Deck, I think, would be the second best gyro implementation currently. I don't know.
I don't know, man. Like, would we need like these dual gyros if we were living on a superior Earth?
Cone Earth?
Oh, I see. The asteroid hit and all the dinosaurs went flying.
It flipped the table and goes,
you guys you don't know anything about astrophysics. It ran out of air.
Oh, it deflated.
Deflated. Okay. It's a deflated Earth model.
Yeah, the flattening Earth. It's in the process of deflating.
Right. Yeah, I don't mess around with gyro. Does the new version? There's a new version of the controller, maybe.
They've done several revisions of the PCB and the firmware. They always update the firmware, obviously. But yeah, it's they're minor revisions, but they're like little things to help. Because as it turns out, they have an entire Discord server dedicated to just people who built it for themselves or fed the
people the who like gyro schematics and everything. Just generally need help.
No, people who genuinely are enthusiasts about gyro and about open source controllers, because you can just either buy the pits from Input Labs now, or you can feed the schematics and everything else to PCBWay or one of the others, hashtag not sponsored, and they will just send you the PCB pre-built and the 3D printed parts 3D printed. And away you go. So there are options there. But yes, if you want a truly accurate gyro, the alpaca is absolutely my recommendation. The Steam Deck is a close second.
I just keep hearing gyro or gyro.
I mean the Steam Deck is not really gyroscope. Useful for this guy's use case, because he was looking for like something to control like an HTPC or something. So
that controller exists. It's going to set you back about like $170. New in box. This is the best HTPC fucking controlling thing ever built, period. It's got the built-in mouse pad. Yeah, like right there.
And the on-screen and the controller keyboard is actually really good.
Like, yeah, plus you can like pick it up and do that, and it feels really good. Like,
it is quite satisfying.
Pad. Yeah, fuck that thing. All that thing that only exists to remind me that it's a touchpad occasionally when I'm like, what the fuck? Oh, right.
When you touch it slightly and the cursor goes, whoop.
What the hell?
That thing only exists because like five games on PlayStation will use that touchpad for like one thing, one mechanic.
Yeah, it's like a swipe and you open the inventory or you swipe. Yeah,
Sony went through all the trouble of adding that shit and every developer went.
It's like for like some mini game for like graffiti and shit, right? Like,
does it support multi-touch or is it just one?
It supports multi-touch.
Oh, no, yeah, no, you can do two finger scrolling.
You can do two finger swipes.
If it just didn't suck so much, it'd be pretty cool.
Well, like the dimensions of it are not like super useful for like trying to control a computer.
No, it's not. It's like there's no way to like.
Even the one on the DualSense is way too small. That's my two indicator and big finger barely fit on there.
Like I can get a thumb on it.
Yeah, this is the thumb.
Yeah.
Well, you grab it and you end up like clicking on shit because your thumb goes on the pad and you
You're not gonna play Protoss Ninja on that very goodly.
You might play Stellar Blade though.
Little touchy patties right here.
The Squareolas.
Squareolas, yes.
Ladies and gentlemen, as we said, send in your feedback, drop us a comment. We might feature it right here on this very show. But hey, if you like what we do, head over to linkschemecast.com, smash that support button. We got Patreon, we got Libra Pay, we got the Bitcoins. And you just like share the show or just come hang out with us live. Over at twitch.tv/LinuxGameCast. We do this every Saturday at 8:30 Eastern. We got a pre-show. We got a bunch of bonus stuff you get if you can kick us a buck a week or $10,000 a week. We got Amazon wish list over there. If you get something for Jordan, for Pedro, for Jill, for the studio. Studio's even worse, man. I shame you right here publicly. But for them, send in a note. They have to read it. It's a horrible idea, but we like to do it. It is tradition.
Get us into trouble.
Yeah, man.
Tradition.
Well, you know, if you need that extra voice sample before you can finish the fucking Pedro model, that's how you do it.
Yeah, yeah, just buy me Amazon gifts and I will train your...
you get him one gift and in the note you just put every single phoneme in English and then he just reads that out and then you can make any word you want.
I will train your voice model. Just buy me Amazon gifts. It's fine.
You know what? Let's start a petition. Pedro needs to be the new voice of the computer in Star Trek.
It's going to be a cussy computer.
What, isn't it? Yeah. It's going to be so irate.
And it's just going to lord over you. Like, you want me to check that warp core?
Yeah, are you sure about that?
Yeah, you're about one sentence away from that warp core just not being here, buddy. Hey, thanks for helping us out. Thank you for your support. We'll give a shout out to Drummer. And did we have somebody drive back in this week? They just popped up on like the...
We did, Down Incognito. Thank you very much for resubbing after the long hiatus. Thank you ever so much.
It was the highest of hiatuses. Don't Google that.
I'm a very hiatus right now.
All right, ladies and gentlemen. On that bombshell, let's cue the music. You can always find us, as I said, 8:30 Eastern time right here on Twitch. We do a bunch of shit. Not only do we do this show, we're going to be back for Trackmania on Tuesdays and Fridays. All the launch codes are over at linuxgamecast.com. Jordan breaks out some Outer Worlds on Thursdays. Like I said, Friday back here. And of course, Saturday, like really, really back here. Come say hi. I double fucking dare you. Social medias, Twitter, at Venn Stone, Blue Sky, just at Venn, probably. Federated Timeline, Mastodon, at Venn, mast.linuxgamecast.com, we're there.
I'm shoving so many dry tacos into my mouth on various social media sites like Blue Sky, I'm Frojo at Mastodon, I'm also at Frojo at mast.linuxgamecast.com, and on Twitter, I am at The Burning Pool.
How many tacos on a stick could Pedro eat?
Five. So are we just talking skewers? Because I can down some skewers.
Yes, wooden sticks. How many wooden sticks can we force feed you before you throw
it? Oh, do I have to eat the sticks as well? That might take a bit longer. Okay.
You know, like how they swallow swords, but it's like that.
Swallow them tacos.
It also might be the business end of a shovel. I don't know.
Well, you can skewer me as much as you'd like over on mast.linuxgamecast.com. It's at unaccounted four, just with the actual number four at the end. That's about it. Just feed me that meat.
Also, interfacinglinux.com, shameless plug. Go check out the description. It's there if you want to see some of the stuff I'm up to. No, credits. Boop. Facts.
That's true.
Correct, yes.
Yeah.
But how would you know it's a dog?
Because it will tell you, it'll be like, hello, I am a skeleton dog. We got to thank our advisors, Omegas and Arthur, and our executive producers, Barbara, Scott, Atomic, Mike, Tomaz, Dave, Eshep, Ian, Kurducky, 1234, Haplo, and Drummer, and our little Nikki fan, Super Desto, Empty, Glorious Eggroll, King Bonge, and Turbo Tree Sloth, who just got sucked
with the sea monsters, Renault, Rider X, Machina, Trudgy, Veritanuda, Justin, Darkwing, System, T, Dancing, Joe, the Cresty, and Ogi-1. With the Death Notes, Nova, Chad, Romeo, Renee, Leonardo, Kim, Chris, Stephen, Jill, Benjamin, Doom2.Wad, Stephen B, Beck, Dodger, Zeno, Rue, Turnover, Pebble, M Foxox, Fine, Jalo, and Piper.
Why do you a bunch of people, all the cheerlings, like Midas Nine? And
all of you. Douglas, Thomas, Belric,
Nova, Fine, Alex, Sandy Cannibals. Thank you so much. Carl, Mike, Arthur, and Lennox, New Orleans, Knockless, Johnny, Shep, Game of Tron again. You know, Idea said, Joe, no, I'll try again. And Kedroy. Ha ha. See, that's the real reason they're written back here. I cheat like a motherfucker. Hey, Dynafire, everybody. We'll see you again next week.
Teetles.
Teetles?
Instead of Toodles.
Fucking Canadians.
Five dudes.